So good morning. Good morning to this dual plenary session of AIEE Energy Symposium, Current and Future Challenges to Energy Security. I am glad to chair this this session. And now we have this session devoted to regulatory challenges and market developments. And we will have 1 hour of time devoted to this in order to discuss, first of all, among our panelists, and also asking for questions from the floor, from the audience, in order to have this fruitful discussion in a wider manner. I am proud to sit here in this session, even if it is run in a virtual mode, with two distinguished experts representing distinguished Association of Distributors in Turkey and Italy, as well as with, I should say, one of the principal voice of the academic perspective. Now, I should say some words about a quick introduction of our panelists today. And first of all, in the speaking order, of course, the first one will be Fabrizio Falconi, Energy Regulation Coordinator, Regulatory Affairs Area in Utilitalia, the well-known Federation of the Italian Utilities, Italy, in the energy field, of course. The second one is Jean-Michel Blachon, Director of the Florence School of Regulation and the holder of the Loyola de Palacio Chair. This is our academic voice, the second panelist. And the third one will be Özden, I hope the pronunciation is correct, the Secretary General of ELDER, Association of Electricity Distribution Turkey. So I will pass over to our panelists, and as I said, in this precise order, and the floor is your, Fabrizio Falconi, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Burtoni. Thank you very much, everybody, and for this opportunity to share point of views and exchange of ideas about the evolution of the energy, European and national energy system, in a sense of more decarbonized path and function of the system itself. I will share some slides that are mainly focused on the possible role of the DSOs, the distribution system operators, electric energy distribution system operators in the energy transition. In just a minute, I will try to share them. Okay. Can you see the slides?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Of course, as told by Mr. Burtoni, my name is Fabrizio Falconi, and I work for the Regulatory Affairs Department of Utilitalia, and I'm in charge for the coordination of the energy regulatory affairs. Just a few words about our federation. Utilitalia is a federation of nearly 450 multi-utilities involved in water, environment, and electric energy and other gas supply chains. And the level of our representation is, of course, well visible by the numbers of the employees working for our associated companies, and also by the number of final customers supplied by our multi-utilities in water, environmental services, and energy services, and electric energy and gas supply. Of course, it means that Utilitalia is strongly involved in the the interaction with the main national and European stakeholders. And in this slide, you may find just a brief summary of the main names of the stakeholders with which we are constantly interacting regarding the main topics of energy fields, main issues and criticalities. And of course, the latest news is about the EU DSO entity that is a very important, a relevant new player of the European overview. It was set up by the Clean Energy Package in order to represent a very important point of reference of all European electric energy DSOs. And we'll talk about it later in a dedicated slide. What about Fit for 55? Of course, we think that the new package will require a strong commitment for the electric energy DSOs. In this slide, you can see just a brief summary of the main targets that are currently under discussion that will lead the European Union and the national state members to reach a very ambitious targets regarding the GHG reduction, but also regarding the share, the percentage of renewable electric energy on the total final consumption. And the clean energy package was already very ambitious on these points, especially for Italy. For our country, in fact, it was required to reach 55% of renewable energy sources on the total final consumption. And from generation capacity installed, it means that we should reach around 52 gigawatts of solar power plants and 19 gigawatts of wind plants. And all of this is very ambitious for our country. And the fact of Fit for 55 that will increase further, increase these targets will lead to some worries about the real possibility to reach everything is needed. And this is this worry is especially for the DSOs that will are required to play a very important key role on these matters. In fact, a growing part of the new renewable energy capacity is expected to be available on distribution grids. What about the current situation of distributed generation in Italy? Currently, we have around 30 gigawatts of installed capacity that is connected to distribution grids. 30 gigawatts of the total 120 gigawatts of the total national installed capacity. And both the number of power plants and also the amount of the gigawatt installed on distribution level are very high. And we think that the Fit for 55 impacts will lead to an additional remarkable increase of a potential congestion criticalities on distribution grid levels. And in order to face this problem, the National Regulatory Authority recently issued a first experimental regulation in order to enable DSOs to present, to develop some pilot projects for local dispatching solutions. These are the main points of this new regulation. And the aim is to promote the DSO's experimental project focused on local ancillary services supply arrangement and remuneration. And this is in line with the main rules defined by the EU Directive 944, included in the energy, in the clean energy package, of course. So DSOs, Italian DSOs may propose a pilot project to the NRA, and the NRA will evaluate this project considering the level of non-discriminatory access from the point of view of the possible participants to these new tools, and also the level of the technological neutrality towards the ancillary services potential suppliers. The regulatory framework considered in this tool is substantially aligned to the one considered within the TSO Terna experimental pilot project that were regulated by the Act number 3. Of course, the level of complexity for the DSOs will be very, very high. In fact, they will have to propose a pilot project after having performed a preliminary analysis of the main requirements in their local grids and also public consultation on a draft regulation. So the final proposal to be sent to the national regulatory authority will have to include a final regulation scheme, a technical relation, and a summary of a public consultation outcomes. However, the DSOs will have a great opportunity to assume an innovative rule, even if it could be not so easy to put in place a pure local ancillary service in markets, just because of the fact would be quite difficult to have very liquid local markets. However, it's a very important breakthrough on the Italian regulation, and we will see the reactions of the main Italian DSOs on these matters. Further technical main points about this new NRA regulation are about the targets that the DSO pilot project will have to identify in their experiments, of course. They will have to define the typology of ancillary services needed, the solutions to obtain ancillary services supply, and they will have to explain how to reach a proper cooperation with the other DSOs and with the TSO. And this is a very important topic to be solved. Furthermore, this project will have to define parameters and a key performance indicator able to evaluate the results of the experimental pilot project. And also they will have to define the typology of units, physical or virtual production or consumption units that will be able to offer the required ancillary services. In addition to this, of course, DSOs will have to define possible tools and equipment to be installed among the units involved in this new pilot project in order to offer the required ancillary services. And of course, DSOs will have to consider also the previous current experiences on a European level and also the possible financial resources to be covered with the costs of these pilot projects. So the level of complexity is quite high for DSOs, and also the regulatory strong projects constraints could dominate this first opening of the regulation to DSOs local dispatching markets or services. However, on a European point of view, as told before, the EU DSO entity has got a very strong importance on this in this scenario for the European DSOs. And the main duties of this entity are about promoting DSO grids development in coordination with the TSOs, facilitating the renewable energy sources integration, distributed generation and power storage, and support demand side flexibility. Furthermore, one of the main duties of the entity is to contribute to the digitalization of distribution grids and facilitation also the cybersecurity and data protection, participating to the definition and actuation of those network codes considered relevant for the effectiveness of the distribution grids and for the cooperation with the TSOs. And also, the last but not the least, one of the main targets is about putting in place best practices regarding data exchange and interoperability. So what we think is that this new institutional and technical point of reference for the European DSOs could play a key role to contribute to reach the decarbonized and clean energy system. And what about some final remarks? Of course, the significant renewable energy sources growth wanted by the Fit for 55 will lead to a strong increase of the distributed generation capacity, and it will reinforce the DSO's key role in the energy transition. Of course, more investments are needed to guarantee a smart, flexible, and effective distribution system. And it requires urgent necessity to assure a proper remuneration of the regulated assets in order to let them promote their financial stability and to promote the strong level of investments and innovation that will involve the DSOs in the next years. And this topic is of course available also regarding the pilot project I was mentioning before, because they will have to be rapidly encouraged, and they will have to have a proper remuneration in order to be properly relevant for their startup phase. And what about the keywords for the future DSOs, for the role of DSOs in a decarbonized energy system? Of course, not only flexibility, but also interoperability with the TSOs, resilience in order to resist and to adapt to the climate change, and of course, digitalization, and that is about the possibility and the need to improve the operational handling of the grids using some digital tools and services. So I just concluded. Thank you very much.
Okay, many thanks, Fabrizio. So I think we can accumulate questions to you and then put them at the end of the complete panel, as well as with other questions coming from the audience, if any. So we go further, and then the second speaker, Jean-Michel Lachan, the floor is yours. Jean-Michel.
Mille grazie, caro Guido. Ladies, gentlemen, good morning, and many thanks to AIEE for this kind invitation. I would like to share with you my views on coming flexible electricity systems. On the demand side, you will see a mix of markets and regulation. Next. Flexibility is at the core of EU decarbonization strategy, because our strategy is electrification with clean energy. This implies 6 times more green electricity than today. We have first to decarbonize the electricity we already consume, plus to start the direct electrification of road mobility, heating and cooling in buildings and for households, and some parts of industrial processes. Plus, at a point to start, indirect electrification of maritime and aviation transportation, other parts of industrial processes via green hydrogen, green ammonia, of course, competing with biofuels, with synthetic fuels from gas plus CCUS, who knows? But today's gas crisis is reminding all of us that flexibility of electricity systems is key. Next. I will do it first by looking at the supply of flexibility on the consumer side, distinguishing 4 types of consumer flexibility, from demand response to system peaks to integrating consumption in a transactive process. Then I will look at the uses of flexibility, distinguishing 3 levels of use: transmission, distribution, behind the meter. Next. First type of consumer flexibility, demand response to system peak pricing. I know, not new. It exists since decades that certain consumers gain by not consuming at peaks. It's even a tradition in France. We call it EGP. It's demand response to seasonal peaks. Mainly professionals do that, but even households. In 2021, if you are ready not to consume on 22 rate days, being at €374 a megawatt hour at retail rate. A new business is come for aggregators. Demand response at all peaks, including daily peaks. It is made EU legal by the clean energy package, but the concrete rules, aggregators versus suppliers, are left national. A leading French in this business, Voltalis, a leading German, Next Kraftwerke, 10,000 clients and 9 gigawatt managed in 2020. It's a typical business of light assets intermediary and trader. Next. Expansion of electricity consumption via electrification of industrial processes will expand the potential business of demand response. And I have already seen industrials studying what could be the right flexibility potential to give to their new investments. Next. Consumer Flex Type 2, managing distributed generation with storage. Expansion of rooftop PV questions the right size of PV assets vis-à-vis size of self-consumption. Plus, the lower storage costs expand the set of choices for prosumers, more than 1 million in California. Management of distributed generation with storage opens the box of price arbitrage. Grid tariffs for peak injection or withdrawal, supplier tariff for energy, support schemes for renewables. The prosumer can decide, act, and react. The German company Sonnen sold already more than 60,000 home storages. Next. Consumer Flex Type 3, managing a flexible load being a storage, electric vehicles. An electric vehicle is both a flexible load, it can charge at different points and different times, and a storage. Smart charging means making arbitrage for EV charging. Vehicle to grid, V2G, adds options of injecting electricity into the grid, giving a wider arbitrage perimeter. EV owners have to choose being active or passive, including for their car, to be able to do V2G. But you may know that Volkswagen now installs V2G on all its EVs. EV owners can also arbitrage charging at home, at work, or in a station. If 15% of the EU fleet was made of EVs, we would have 40 million EVs being cars, more than 2 terawatt hours of batteries on wheels. Next. Consumer Flex Type 4, integrating key consumption devices into a transactive process. We know that it's not so easy for consumers to evaluate all options and to manage well their flexibility at home, in a shop, in a building. But this can be automated via a proper digitalization of key consumption devices with sensors measuring this or that, actuators controlling the quantity of energy used, and controller doing the calculation and communicating with external actors. Let's look at cases of transactive energy in the US. A proof of concept named RATES in suburb of Los Angeles for 3 years, now tested at scale in Colorado, project tests with 58,000 participants. Next. Each key device gets sensors to measure things and actuator to control the use of energy. You see battery, pool pump, we are in California, heating and cooling, and electric vehicle. Next. Each device also obeys to owner preferences, plus a matching learning advice, integrating in a home, integrating controller, a kind of small computer. You see initial condition, owner preferences, local weather forecast, device sensors, etc., etc. Next. Thanks to a dedicated electronic platform, all these arm controllers interact with system operator pricing in California, California ISO, and supplier tariffs in California, this region, Southern California Edison. You see, consumption is fully integrated into markets decision making. Next. Now, level of use of these flexibilities. Transmission first. Needs of flexibility at transmission level vary from one country to another. And in the same country, it varies from one electricity mix to another. Let's look at the French transmission system operator, RTE, just released 2050 net zero study. Its central scenario sees electricity consumption in 2050 at plus 200 terawatt hours, plus 40%. But if France have in 2050 51 gigawatts of nuclear, today we have 61, and 135 gigawatts of renewables, the whole France flexibility given by demand response and V2G will be at 15 gigawatts, enough to get France security of supply with only one additional gigawatt of system battery. But if France had no nuclear at all and 345 gigawatts of renewable, France security of supply will need additional 26 gigawatts of system battery and 29 gigawatts of decarbonized thermal plants. Next. Second level of use, distribution level. We have seen, it's another story, but we have seen the French TSO expecting 135 gigawatts to 345 gigawatts renewable in France 2050, with 110 gigawatts to 285 gigawatts connected to distribution grids. A lot of investments to come needed. And investments also mean costs. Next. But at distribution level, flexibility can also be a tool to reduce network investments. On the left-hand side, a German study in blue wind, in yellow solar, with 3-4% curtailment of renewable injections, one might save 40%, 50% investment needs. On the right-hand side, cost and benefits calculation by France School, but I have no time to enter into it. Next. What is the flexibility toolbox that we need to organize flexibility at distribution level? Left-hand side, the European Association of Regulators, CER. On the right-hand side, the European Association of DSOs. Oh, they look the same. Network tariff, tariff solutions, connection agreement solution, market-based procurement, market-based solution, rule-based approach, rule-based solution. Oh. The DSOs are only adding technical solutions using grid assets, which looks correct because they are the professionals of the distribution grids. They know things that regulators do not look closely at. So do we have a deal? Next. No, we have a deal on the names of the chapters. But there is 22 options within these chapters, and European regulators and European DSOs did not agree and do not agree yet. Next. But European transmission system operators and distribution system operators met in June to discuss a regulatory framework for distributed flexibility with 24 recommendations in four areas. Ah, is it a deal? No. One-third of disagreements. Market access and rules for aggregation, five topics, 100% agreement. Measurement, validation, settlement, five topics, 100% agreement. But product design and procurement, five topics, 100% disagreement. Market processes and transmission distribution coordination, 10 topics, 40% disagreement. We do not have a deal between TSOs and DSOs. We have negotiation, and we do not have a deal with these grid system operators and regulators. Deal not yet done. Next. Third level, behind the meter. Remember that aggregators and retailers both play in the wholesale market. Retailers buy wholesale and fraction it for the consumers. Aggregators buy at consumers and repack at a wholesale side. But many, many other actions always stay at the consumption level. Therefore, behind the meter of the distribution grid, as decentralized generation, decentralized storage, management of EV charging and of V2G, etc. Here, the consumption flexibility can be directly integrated with operation of decentralized generation, operation of decentralized storage. It is the third level of flexibility, the behind the meter flexibility. Next. Prosumers and prosumers can prefer to get this integration of their assets with their consumption from an asset-light professional. Look at UK. Supplier Octopus does it for owners of a Tesla, plus Powerwall storage, plus roof PV, guaranteeing the smallest price for all complementary energy supplies they will need. Sonnen in Germany does something similar with the batteries itself, offering an energy community to their owners. The highest Sonnen battery Econlix 10 kilowatt hours also offer to control the consumption devices at home. Ausgrid and Reposit Power in Australia guarantee 5 years of free energy supply to all households investing into 6.6 kilowatt PV and 11.8 kilowatt hour storage monitored and managed by Reposit Power home controller. Next. The EU legal definition of energy communities in the clean energy package might open the way to other collective actions independent of market-based suppliers' undertaking. See the coming pioneering community, ZOLA, initiative of Allensbach, Baden-Württemberg, having got the Innovation Award 2021 by Renewable Grid Initiatives last week. Empowerment of prosumers and prosumers can also give rise to peer-to-peer sharing of PV, storage, EV charging in a sharing economy scheme. Digital platforms can play there a big role to simplify trade and transactions. Next. Conclusions one. Wider electrification of EU energy systems will increase the role of decentralized resources, be they generation or storage, and increase the value of a deeper digitalization of consumption devices, its pumps or EVs. Internet of Things will permit billions of devices to emit, to receive, to act, and to interact. Conclusion two, proper regulatory frame to reach the full potential of this wave is not yet defined. But regulators, grid operators, utilities, independent businesses, prosumers, communities, EV owners are already thinking and testing for the success of our EU 2030 decarbonization targets. One needs this EU Big Bang to succeed. Next. Grazie mille a tutti e per Natale, add to your wish list my handbook on LGC markets, just edited with Paul Joskow, MIT, and Michael Polite, University of Cambridge. You have it printed or ebook the way you want, with 50% reduction on the printed copy, 25% reduction on the ebook. Next. Per trovarmi, Twitter, GM Glashan. 105,000 tweets. Here, you will get access to the 50% reduction and 25% reduction. And from 1st January 2022, I am your world president elect, IEEE, and of course, all Italians will be cherished as dear friends. That's it. Thank you for the IEEE helping for the slides.
Okay, many thanks, Jean-Michel, and then the best wishes, not only for Christmas, but for your new capacity, new mandate of president of the International Association of Energy Economists. And now we have the Mr. Osden, the speaker, on his view about the regulatory challenges and market developments. And then I think at 11:30, we are on time, we will have some question. Please, Mr. Osden. Excuse me, we cannot hear you. Maybe you are muted. Not yet. Here we go, I think.
Okay.
Please go ahead.
I hope you can hear me now. I would like to thank IEEE first for the nice and kind invitation, and I also would like to say hi to the other participants and thank for their nice presentations. Today I'd like to talk about regulatory challenges and developments in Turkey. I will start with the current challenges in Turkish electricity market, mainly resulting from the price developments all over the globe, and also particularly in Turkey, because of the rising energy prices. So this will be my first chapter, and my second chapter will be the new regulatory framework for the incumbent retail sales company and also distribution companies. So I'd like to give a brief understanding about the evolution of Turkish electricity market. Turkish electricity market is on the path for privatization and liberalization for the last 40 years. I can say that Turkey Electricity Corporation, which is a state company, dominated the market until 1994. However, from 1994 on, unbundling and specialization of public companies started. And starting with the year 2001, privatization and liberalization speeded up because a new legal framework is approved by the parliament. So today's market structure arose, and the privatization is almost finished between 2013 and 2021. So what kind of structure we have at the moment in Turkish energy business? We have, as the chain of the value, we have generation. Now 76% of installed capacity is coming from private participation, and we have almost 2,000 generation companies at generation site. Transmission, I think it's almost at any other country, is that belongs to a public company called TEİAŞ, and we have organized markets and wholesale markets. We have spot energy exchange at EPİAŞ. It's a partnership between public and private companies, and we have Istanbul Stock Exchange for the derivatives. So it, at the moment, it's possible to exchange physically and financially electricity. And apart from that, I think as everywhere, bilateral agreements are always on the table. We have 21 regions and 21 distribution companies at distribution sites, and their sister companies are incumbent suppliers. They are all belonging to the private companies. But apart from that, the market is quite lively. There are almost 220 independent suppliers on the market. So this is where we have arrived during the path of privatization and liberalization. And so what we have accomplished so far, power market firmly set for competitive regime took place. Implementation of a market-based utility sector framework is in progress. However, obstacles against free market structure arise in recent years. I'll give some idea about this point. So we have increased private participation. We have established well-developed and stable institutional framework. We have enhanced liberalization, competition, transparency, and efficiency. And at the right-hand side of the slide, you can see the main accomplishments. So there are some details over there. And to continue with, as a result, almost 50% of the transactions, electricity transactions in the market takes place in organized markets. We have day-ahead markets, intraday markets, and balancing power markets. But these numbers belong to 2020. And in 2021, bilateral agreements, or what we can say as over-the-counter markets, lost some weight because the prices in organized markets boomed. So the prices in the OTC market stayed low. So there's kind of a passage from one side to another. And this this affected all market conditions, to be honest. So normal price formation is normally quite like somewhere else. It's there's a merit order working on. And most of the hours of the year, CCGTs, natural gas, determine the market price. But in some other times, imported coal plays a role. And it's interesting here, natural gas is subsidized by the government. So import prices are higher than the market prices. Therefore, in the recent times, imported coal determines more the hourly prices. And as you can see at the right-hand side of the slide, a peak load from 2019 to 2020 and then 2021 has increased 10% consecutively. So what I believe is in the upcoming years, there will be some supply security issues because of the lack of investments in the based thermal power plants. And which thermal power plants we should invest is another question, because in the recent months, Turkey has signed a climate agreement. So now we have totally another kind of framework that we have to comply with. And is it all working on the market? Honestly, not. We have another kind of, let's say, renewable energy support mechanism called YEKA. And at YEKA, we conduct Dutch auctions, and 2,000 megawatt installed capacity is being established at the moment, and further auctions are coming. But a bit contrary to the climate concerns, we support local coal power plants, and because they are local, so they decrease account deficit somehow, but they are polluting the climate, to be honest. And we have capacity mechanism, and the interesting thing is at the moment capacity mechanism is only considering the variable costs. but now it's drafted again, and it's most probably will consider both fixed and variable costs. And another thing is we have build operate transfer and transfer of operating rights at the fifth column. And these power plants are CCGTs and invested in 1990s, because in 1990s, we had some supply security issues. And what I see at the moment in Belgium, in also partially in UK, the governments have to regulate the base load power plants, because I think private companies will not favor investments in that regard because of the climate issues. And I believe same thing would be the case in Turkey in the coming years. And we have one nuclear power plant which is being built, and you can see the details in the sixth column. It's probably will be the first reactor will be operational in 2023 or 2024. And we have to talk about these energy subsidies. There are many subsidies, and these are not sustainable, to be honest. And at the left side of the slide, you see gas tariffs and import prices at the moment. So starting from the energy crunch in the European markets, governments started to subsidize the internal market prices, so that what I forecast is BOTAŞ, National Natural Gas Company, will have some losses equal to $5 to $6 billion in only 2021, which is a huge problem, and it's not sustainable because average tariffs are continuously below average import price. By the way, 99% of natural gas is being imported by Turkey. And at the electricity markets, you see at the right-hand side, end user prices, regulated versus free market. Free market, including feed-in tariff, are illustrated with yellow columns. And when the yellow columns are below the lines, which are household, commercial, and industrial regulated prices, then there is no free market. And in 2018, there has been no free market in Turkey, almost no free market, because TL has depreciated too much. And after that, for 2019 and 2020, we have gained the advantage of having a strong free market, but the situation has changed in the last three quarters. Again, all the customers are passing to regulatory regulated market, because regulated market is being subsidized and the prices there are below free market. So challenge is the incumbent companies have to take these additional consumption and customers, but they cannot reimburse by the tariffs which whose costs are reflected to them. So at the moment, I think 8 billion Turkish liras are not reimbursed to the incumbent companies. It's a huge financial problem at the market. So it's another challenge, as we can see with numbers. And we talked about subsidies. I think we all agree there are two kinds of subsidies: market distortive subsidies, which are endogenous to the market, right? And in this kind of subsidies, prices which do not reflect or partially reflect costs distort investment environment, because we cannot foresee the price signal so that we cannot invest, which means that there will be supply security issues in the near future. So this threatens supply security, but also social welfare in medium term, because the prices hike. When you subsidize too much, too deep, this is the result. And the second kind of subsidies are market neutral subsidies, which are exogenous to the market. Somebody has to pay. Most of the time, treasury or alike sources pay the bill, and they are socialized to the society, but they do not affect the market. I think this is the question at European level at the moment. And I think we would discuss more in 2022, this kind of stuff. So let me briefly explain energy subsidies in Turkey. National gas companies' tariffs are subsidized, as you could see in the previous slide. National electricity generation and trade company, they are bundled 2 years ago. Their tariffs are subsidized. Therefore, free market electricity is, I can say, dead at the moment. And regulated tariffs are subsidized also. And there's a cross subsidy for households, which is not enough. There will be gradual household tariffs from 2022 on, so that lower tariffs will be valid for below certain consumption threshold. And price ceiling for day ahead market is on the table for the last, let's say, 14 months or 1 year and a half almost. So the ceiling price is limited with three times of previous 12 months average before last 2 months. It's a bit complicated, but let's say three times of the actuals of the last 12 months. So at the moment, I can say this is equals to something like 75 euro per megawatt hour. So you can just think, you know, with your countries, this is a very low price, but and this doesn't reflect the market reality. So I can say that these are all in the first group, but the seventh is the only market neutral subsidy. And in this kind of subsidy, Ministry of Family and Social Services provides direct cash support to 2.1 million families in Turkey. So this is more like the one in France, but the one we have is more permanent, let's say. It's not temporary. That's the difference. So I have a second chapter, but I think we are out of time, so I can stop here. Thank you very much for your time, invitation, and interest. Thank you.
Many, many thanks, Özge. And then we saw a very tough situation of your, let's say, power system and power system regulation. And I think you have a lot of work to do there.
That's right. Okay. That's right. Thank you.
I would ask, let's say, AIEE staff if there is some, let's say, some questions coming from the floor. Let me know in order to, let's say, read and put this question. I didn't see any message in the chat room, so I will go further. We have, I think, 7 minutes more for this session. I have a question, let's say, a collective question to all of you panelists, and then I will put this in a very, very quick manner. Of course, we are dealing in our session with the regulation and markets, but we have to refer to security, to energy security issue, because this symposium is titled Energy Security Issue. I saw the best definition of the regulation, which is one of the two pillars of our session. The best definition of a regulation I have ever seen or found during my reading is as follows. Regulator should sit at the interconnection and the intersection between law on one side and markets on the other side. This is a copyright by Creux, the French regulator, is not mine, but I think is a very good definition. So the intersection between, let's say, law and all, let's say, policies, etc., and the market. This is the point where regulation stand for this topic. I would like to know, taking, let's say, in the light of this definition, how is your view, dear panelists, about the ability of markets to maintain or to guarantee the security of supply, the operating security, and in particular, the security at an affordable price, of course, which is a very actual, a very current topic in Europe and in other parts of the world. So how is your view about the security of supply at affordable price? I will propose the same order as before. So Fabrizio, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bottoni, for this interesting question. I think that in Italy, the role of the national regulatory authority has always been very, very important and relevant to find the right balance between market functioning, well functioning, and also the need to solve matters coming from the problems, criticalities from the markets, because the markets alone is not always able to offer a wide range of solutions to the final consumers, to the final customers, and this is often the scenario in Italy. For example, currently we are facing some problems regarding the energy crunch, the energy prices that are going very high during the last months, and the government had to put in place some interventions in order to mitigate this phenomenon. But this phenomenon is also about the generation level, for example, the generation of electric energy, which we have in Italy, for example, the capacity markets tool. This is a very important tool, regulated tool, in order to assure that the national energy system is able to face security and adequacy problems in a context in which renewable energy sources are really playing a very important and more important role year by year. So the National Regulatory Authority, as an independent entity, is really important to find the right balance between market and the regulation. Of course, when you were president of the Italian National Regulatory Authority, you had many problems to face and many criticalities to solve. And I think you could also offer many examples of this kind of intervention that you in which you have been involved many times in the past.
Yes, many thanks, but it is not my role of today to elaborate on this topic. So the view of Jean-Michel, maybe you have the recipe already in your electricity market handbook, but maybe you can elaborate, Jean-Michel, a little bit on this question, how to maintain the security of supply at affordable price with...
First, open markets, self-regulated markets cannot deliver security of supply, because we generate with natural resources, gas, coal, oil, they are natural resources. So scarcity can be very high, and it's not possible to supply more. So we know that with oil shocks since many years, because they are natural resources, that's life. It can be the same with wheat, it can be the same with many other things. And because you are adding affordability. If you were not adding affordability, markets can work, we all know. Prices will go to the roof, people will be discouraged to use it, unfortunately, because they do not have unlimited revenues, and professionals will also be discouraged because they cannot use such a pricey resource if they have to produce something with. So if we want to add all this supplementary constraint, which is always to have supply is guaranteed, affordability is guaranteed, we need regulation. Do we need regulation of markets, or do we need regulation of operation? This, it's up to us, I would say even up to you. As Fabrizio just said, we may have dedicated markets, capacity market, So we will have enough generation capacity, but it does not guarantee the resource as gas, as we are discovering. Huh? We are all discovering. Flexibility markets, Fabrizio also told it, flexibility at local level, it has to be discovered because even Bruegel Institute last week said European industry is not yet very flexible. Given the price of gas, many industries should stop producing, even if we use again the trick of the pandemic, which is to cover the salaries of the employees. They do not work, but they are covered. And then all this gas is giving back to the other consumers. Also, to take care of nuclear, in France, 30% of the nuclear is not generating.
Yes.
So we may estimate over the winter, 50 terawatt hours of electricity will not be produced by nuclear, but by gas. So we have to organize gas security of supply, which way, unfortunately, where we are in the crisis, it's not easy to organize. Before the crisis, it's easy. During the crisis, it's not. And as you know, Guido and Fabrizio too, in France and Italy, we will have enough gas to go through the winter because we have gas storage mandatory. But because of the Netherlands, of Germany and Austria mainly, we do not have enough gas at the European level. And European power is weak. On this, I assume Guido won't say the opposite. National powers are strong, but they cannot easily coordinate. European power is weak. European power can act, European government, if you want, can act if all countries agree. When all countries agree, we can act. We have seen for vaccine. But
yes,
these days, where is a strong coalition of countries telling do this, do that?
Yes.
This said, I said everything I was willing to tell. A last thing, which should be a joke, but is not. When Juncker came to lead European Commission in 2015, he was coming with energy union. A part of energy union was to have gas coordination between all countries. It was pushed by Poland at the European Parliament and at the European Council. And it was impossible to get. So we didn't get a significant law on gas since 6 years. Instead of addressing gas issues, we didn't do anything.
Yeah. And then we will have maybe today the get the gas market package after 6 years. So one word for you, Özden.
Okay.
I have get 1 minute.
Unfortunately,
more.
No time has been left, but so only 30 seconds. I think I agree with Jean-Michel. There's a contradiction between supply security, climate and environment, and also prices. So we have to satisfy all these three requisites, let's say. And this is what I call impossible trinity, like in economics. So it's a trilemma, in fact. And I agree again with Jean-Michel, policies or regulation sets will not be enough to satisfy, markets will not be enough to satisfy all three. So we need policies and regulations to make it possible. But at the end of the day, there will be a price that the people have to pay for all. So subsidies somehow in the upcoming future for all of us, also in Europe and Turkey, will be part of our life. So I think we will focus more on which subsidies will be supporting the people when not distorting the markets. Thank you very much.
Many thanks to all of you and many thanks for the attention given by the floor. And then the session is over.
Congratulations, Özgür. Remarkable.